I'm glad that David Buss mentioned the fact that we should take our ancestral environment seriously and figure out the relationship between what's going on in our head today is and what went on at that time. So I'd first like to make a comment about science, heavy-duty science. You know, from an evolutionary point of view, heavy-duty science doesn't make much sense because it's not very adaptive, because it slows your reaction time. You see, whereas these folk sciences that all so good, that Bob Macaulay told us that this is all air, you know, I mean, not air, empty space, sorry, empty space. The fact of the matter is, from point of view of folks' physics, I can't get my hand through it, so I'm not going to try to walk through a wall either. So I think that we better not underplay the value of what evolution has contributed to us, our folk sciences, okay? So, first of all, let me tell you what, by the way, at this time of the day, everything has already been said, so I can just repeat what everyone else has said, okay? So what are the aims of the cognitive science of religion? It's supposed to give you a theoretically sophisticated account of religion, whatever that is, including the fact that, by the way, from one point of view, religion is an aggregate term. It doesn't really, it's not a unified term at all, but it's an aggregate term only if you understand the theory that produced the concept of an aggregate term. Secondly, cognitive science of religion is supported by empirical and experimental studies. You better be. And thirdly, it employs theories, methods, and results wherever they might be found. And that's why it's a truly interdisciplinary project. Now, I think it's very important to distinguish between the attitudes that people have. Is religion, this aggregate term, something to be condemned? No. Is it something to be commended? No. What is its job? To develop an explanatory understanding of what's going on in religion. So, on the one hand, you have people like Dawkins writing The God Delusion, which of course is a very, very popular book. That is designed, in a sense, to condemn religion. And then you have Justin Barrett, Why Would Anyone Believe in God? At least the last chapter is designed to commend religion, okay? I don't think that that there's anything in the practice of cognitive science that requires either of those approaches. And the reason I'm saying this is because if you're ever going to have a dialogue between science and the scientific thinker and the religious thinker, I think you're going to need to make it very, very clear that you're neither in the condemnation nor in the commendation attitude. So, what is actually going on is the study of our minds at work. It provides no threat to religious thought or behavior. That's the conclusion I come to. As long as we distinguish between mental processes and their reference, okay? Everyone wants to argue about, is there a God or not? I'm much more interested in how our minds produce ideas like God. So let me give you an example. If you're going to have understand what's going on in religion, let's look at what happens in the actual field. Now, I happen to do a great deal of ethnographic work, and I'm actually going out into the boondocks and talking to people, and I'll give you some example there. But anyway, when you install a chief, you're going to have certain kinds of ritual activities performed. And in order to understand what's going on in that activity, when a chief is installed, there's going to be a great deal of ritual drumming among the Zulu. because they just love the drums. Okay? But there's a special way of beating those drums. And it takes a great deal of expertise to learn how to beat those drums. Now, from a cognitive point of view, in order to understand what's going on there, there's really very, very little difference between a ritual drummer beating a ritual drum and an ordinary drummer beating an ordinary drum, okay? So part of the problem is that many people start looking for a special little spot in the brain that somehow there will be that religious G spot, you know, with the God spot in the brain, where you can find what's really motivating what's going on. I think what we need to understand is that the same cognitive resources that we have to represent ritual drumming are the same cognitive resources we have to understand ordinary drumming. So then this becomes the issue. Why do religious ideas persist? Now, a great deal of emphasis today has been focused upon religious beliefs. But you know, you don't have to believe any religious idea in order to persist. Because you can entertain an idea, transmit an idea without believing it. Take, for example, the idea of Mickey Mouse or Santa Claus, or the Easter Bunny. Now, who in this room believes in the Easter Bunny? Be honest and raise your hand. Yeah, I knew you would do that. Except for this odd guy. You see, you don't. But naturally, you are the same people that are corrupting the minds of the little kids by telling them about the Easter Bunny. That's how these ideas get transmitted from generation to generation. There's still Santa Claus around because you told those little kids about Santa Claus. There's still God around because someone told those little kids about God too, okay? So I think we need to focus more upon the transmission problem than simply the belief problem. Why do people believe? Well, some people believe, some people don't. But there's ideas. Once they're entertained, they get transmitted from generation to generation. So in the competition of ideas, what is it about these concepts that get transmitted that are so interesting? Well, as Bob McCauley already told us this morning, they're attention grabbing. They grab our attention. Secondly, they're memorable. Thirdly, they're transmittable. And we know all these on the basis of good science, namely the experimental work that has been done, for example, focusing upon the whole notion of how an infant can show surprise. I'm sure you all know those experiments. Okay, and if you want to read a book about the subject, read Alison Gopnik and Friends, The Scientist in the Crib. Or see Philippe Rochard's The Infant World. What I've been interested in doing the last few years in South Africa is testing some of the ideas that have emerged in the context of precautionary psychology, which I noticed David was hinting at. First of all, I've learned that there's a kind of common idea among people that one of the theories of the popular mind is that people entertain religious ideas because of fear, okay? So I decided to test this idea in the field of whether it's fear or not. Well, in order to understand what's going on with regard to the psychology of fear, I discovered that you ought to make a distinction between imminent danger and potential danger. Let me give you an example of this. My colleague Joel Mort and I decided to put ourselves in a situation of danger. We went to a part of the Kruger National Game Reserve where there were some pretty wild elephants. But we just wanted to see these elephants and take pictures of them. But they told us, you know, be careful when you go up there because they're not uh, as adapted to the visitors as people touring the park up there, because it's there aren't all that many people driving around on these little dirt roads. Well, we came across an elephant on the side of the road, looked perfectly friendly, tearing down a tree. So here I'm taking pictures of this elephant turning down the tree, and the elephant is completely ignoring us. And then Joel and I were both looking, and then we heard crunch, crunch, crunch. Now, my vigilance, you know, my precautionary psychology immediately began to work, okay? What's going on here? Well, all of a sudden we looked around, and here, about 15 feet behind us, stood the most massive bull elephant that you can imagine. These bull elephants are known for just picking up VWs and turning them upside down in the park, okay? Well, what I said was, holy shit, let's get out of here, you know? And Joe put his foot on the accelerator, and no time, we were about a mile down the road, which we then turned around and took pictures of this poor elephant looking at us, because he was on the verge. By the way, the reason we know this, at that moment, a ranger came up in a car, saw the elephant and said, oh my God, and he turned his car around the same direction as we were going, because he said, this is a dangerous situation, okay? Anyway, I'm interested in precautionary psychology, because one of the things that I've learned from talking to evolutionary psychologists is that there are certain kinds of threats that we are attuned to. Predation and assault, contagion and contamination, decline in resources, and change in social status. And so what we decided to do is to, in the populations we were studying, both in the city of Pretoria, comparing that with what was going on in Northern Ireland, and in what was going on in KwaZulu-Natal. So we had three different populations. We told the same kind of stories to each of these populations. And we were interested in whether, given the cultural context, whether there would be a different ranking of what was the greater threat. So given four different kinds of threats, which threat is regarded as the greater? I can tell you right now the results, because is that predation and assault was regarded as the greatest threat, followed by contagion and contamination, then decline in resources, and change in social status last. Now, I want to tell you briefly, I put all that up at the same time, tell you briefly about my conversation with a Zulu herbalist, or what people call a witch doctor, because I decided that I wanted to have a dialogue with him, okay? He was going to be the religious thinker, and I was going to be the scientist in dialogue with him. So I said, look, I've heard, ever since I've been here in South Africa, and I was there over a four-year period, by the way, ever since I've been in South Africa, if you take a car from Pietermaritzburg, which is in KwaZulu-Natal, to Johannesburg, that it's very dangerous to drive that way. He said, yes, that's true. I said, now, as an herbalist or a doctor, could you prescribe me some medicine that I can take to prevent my car from being stolen? Because one of the things that they do is they lay in the middle of the road, you're driving, you stop, they jump up, show that they got guns, make you get out of the car, usually shoot you, but not always, and then take your car, okay? So anyway, I said, I would like to be prevented from this. What can you give me? So he said, oh, No problem. Just take this powder. You take this powder, and it'll prevent people from seeing your car, from stealing your car. I said, come on. By the way, if you get engaged in dialogue, you better be willing to argue. You know, you don't have to accept what someone else says. So I said, oh, come on. Are you saying that this car is going, this solid object is going to disappear? Oh, no, I wouldn't be so stupid as to say something like that. Well, what are you trying to say? He said, oh, my powder that you swallow changes that guy's perception so that he won't see the car. Okay, so notice what he has done is he has changed the level of explanation from the physical to the psychological. And you know, there are psychological experiments like Justin Barrett has done, which show, in fact, that people don't want to have God really make this table disappear. Okay, that's not the kind of thing that God bothers about. Okay. God likes to operate on the level of mind. Anyway. Excuse me? What? Oh, no, I didn't. No, because I told him ultimately I didn't believe me. He was willing to, well, we had a wonderful, after a conversation that lasted an entire African evidence. But anyway, to get back now to the theory, you know, a lot of the others we've heard today too, we're designed for animacy and agent detection. And the only difference, I think, is the fact that these agents that we talk about in religious contexts have just special qualities. As Bob McCauley would once again say, they're modestly counterintuitive, you know? There are experiments which show that things that are massively counterintuitive are more difficult to remember and therefore more difficult to transmit. So false positives, I think false positives are wonderful because it's better to be safe than sorry, you see. So a great deal of, so I, in a sense, I'm defending folk science, okay? I think folk science, there are very, very good reasons from an evolutionary point of view why folk science is there, why it's around, because it really made us be here today. And I think that's all I'm going to have to say for now. Thank you very much.